Can we expect a big one from the sun after the solar storm recently? It happened again. Recently, a strong solar storm hit our planet, giving its inhabitants the fantastic sight of polar auroras even at low latitudes, and causing numerous small annoyances with all electrical equipment. It even threw off Starlink, Elon Musk's satellite constellation. We had a similar experience back in 1989 when the power grid in northeastern Canada was knocked out during a solar storm. In just 90 seconds, the region went from normal functioning to suddenly 6 million people without electricity. It took 9 hours to reroute electricity in that part of the power grid. Repairs took months, but that wasn't even a major solar flare. After an extreme solar storm, the problems would be on a much larger scale. The one that hit us just a few days ago is said to have been the most violent magnetic storm in the last two decades, and yet even this one passed without causing major damage. But how can we be sure that one day a super solar storm won't hit Earth, capable of killing us, instead of just disrupting Musk's satellites and our cell phones? Some say it feels like our star is sending us warning signals, and that the little bastard, not at all the friendly source of life with a smiling face usually drawn by children, has been doing something decidedly unpleasant for millennia. Namely, it's been trying continuously to kill us, and there's no guarantee that it won't succeed one day. And then we'll talk. Alright, it's any given night in the near future. Without warning, the lights go out. A sudden loss of electrical power hits the entire country. Air traffic control goes offline. Hospitals switch to backup generators while the sky is adorned with fluorescent colored streamers. The blackout drags on. It seemed like it could be the usual local outage, but hours turn into days and the power doesn't come back. There's no internet. No television, no newspapers to tell you what's going on. Soon the diesel fuel powering hospital emergency generators run out and food stops arriving at supermarkets because the fuel for delivery trucks can't be pumped without electricity. Why isn't anything working anymore? The first news comes through word of mouth. It seems that this time the sun means business, and for at least 2 days it's been bombarding us with an extraordinarily powerful solar storm. In short, the sophisticated technological devices that sustain our chaotic and complex civilization are being disabled by a hailstorm of wicked particles that the solar wind is delivering to us with the energy of 1,000 atomic bombs. Once again, the plasma jet ejected from the sun, that's what we're dealing with here, completed its journey from the sun to Earth at nearly 1,000 kilometers per second, covering 150 million kilometers in just a couple of days. And then, it took only a few seconds to breach the defenses of Earth's magnetic field and throw the global power grid into chaos. The threat comes from outer space, and indeed it's the neural network of our artificial satellites that first feels the destructive effect of the incoming electric charges. Consequently, the cover provided by the global positioning system also goes down, leaving ships, cars, and even anti-theft systems blind. The event also limits air traffic. Many flights are delayed because aircraft cannot take off safely. Pilots in flight must continue without GPS and other instruments. Air corridors in polar regions are closed and routes are diverted. Then all aircraft are grounded before it's too late. Of course, the TVs go off, but so do the phones. Almost immediately, the water also goes out, at least in apartment buildings, where the pumps to raise it to the floors are electric. And household appliances stop working. The goods in large industrial refrigerators start to rot. All of this happens because violent induced currents are created in the energy distribution lines, and the transformers melt. There's no way to replace or repair them. Spare parts cannot be brought in, and making new ones won't be possible either, because industrial plants, including refineries, are all shut down. But that's not all. Trains and subways are also unusable. It's even difficult to get gasoline because there's no electricity to operate the pumps. Pipelines for oil and gas don't work because they require energy. Nuclear power plants have shut down automatically. Malfunctions in traffic signal systems cause accidents. Emergency services are difficult to reach because radio communication is disrupted. Authorities struggle to properly inform the population about the situation and disseminate recommendations on behavior to follow because communication channels are partially out of service. Several purification plants no longer function correctly and discharge polluted water and hazardous substances into the environment. But the most dangerous substance of all is the one gifted to us by the fury of the sun. Solar wind releases high-energy particles that can generate harmful radiation for humans, similar to low-energy nuclear radiation. The Earth's atmosphere and magnetosphere provide adequate protection at ground level, but astronauts in space are subjected to potentially lethal doses of ionizing radiation. The penetration of high-energy particles into cells can cause chromosomal damage, cancer, and other health problems. High doses could be fatal. After a week, the situation worsens and becomes tragic. Entire categories of patients die. Intensive care units, for example, and dialysis units, the most dependent on machines, are emptied. Medicines can no longer be found, and supermarket shelves remain empty. Tall buildings are abandoned. Many seek refuge in the countryside. Nowadays, everything arrives by order, from medicines to cars, from computers to spare parts. And when the distribution network breaks down, it's the collapse. After almost a month, nothing's still working. Heating and air conditioning, ATMs, traffic lights, and industries, everything is still at a standstill. In banks, people discover that real money hardly exists anymore. They're just numbers on monitors, now turned off. No one can access their savings. A month after the blackout began, the world is on the brink. To transmit news, ham radio operators come back into fashion. Some manage to power their radios with solar panels. Does it all seem damn unlikely? Not according to a report from the National Academy of Sciences, published in the United States in January, which states that returning to normalcy will take a long time. We're talking about years, maybe even a decade. The consequences will be severe. Up to 300 million deaths, in addition to economic damages equal to those of dozens of hurricanes like Katrina. But on what scale would a storm of this magnitude strike? Well, for communications and everything related to satellites, the damage would be global. As for electrical problems, the affected areas would involve entire continents. Regions of the Earth above 45 degrees north and below 45 degrees south would be more at risk. Paradoxically, the equatorial belt would be more protected because it's generally less technologically advanced and therefore less vulnerable. Hey guys, just a second before we continue, be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. Okay, someone might object, but up until now you've only talked about the effects. But exactly what are these storms made of? From time to time, violent explosions and eruptions occur on the surface of the sun, ejecting plasma at speeds of hundreds or even thousands of kilometers per second. Mass ejections are accompanied by intense gamma, X, and ultraviolet rays, and by an emission of high-energy charged particles. Radioactive rain can reach the Earth in less than 10 minutes, causing an intensification of electromagnetic radiation, solar storm. The coronal mass ejection weakens Earth's magnetic field. The disruption triggers geomagnetic and electromagnetic storms in Earth's magnetosphere. There are basically two phases. In the first immediate phase, the eruption causes radioactive rain, gamma rays, X-rays, UV rays, protons, etc. The radiological storm reaches Earth after 8 to 12 minutes. In the second phase, which occurs after 18 to 36 hours, Earth is hit by a shock front. The particle stream near Earth increases again, and the impact of the shock with Earth's magnetosphere causes the phenomena of the magnetic storm. Then the currents induced by the storm begin to cause damage, and the dramatic sequence of events we describe begins. Why fear the possibility of a super solar storm when, so far, we have fortunately only experienced disturbances that, while certainly annoying, were definitely bearable? Is it just pessimism, or is there more to it? No, there's just an awareness of the fact that our planet has already dealt with destructive solar events. Our luck has simply been this. The superstorms we know of targeted Earth when our species did not depend at all on technology as sophisticated as today's. And I'll give you just two examples. In 1859, the English astronomer Richard Carrington managed to find a correlation between the onset of solar storms and the appearance of polar auroras. On September 1st of the same year, Earth fell victim to the most intense solar storm on record. It was called the Carrington Event because it was the scientist himself who first observed, on the solar photosphere, the flare that would soon disrupt our magnetosphere. The skies over much of the world, even over Cuba, the Bahamas, and Hawaii, saw splendid polar auroras. But 18 hours after the observation of the flare, a major geomagnetic storm also occurred on Earth. Telegraph operators were first to notice. The keys they used to tap out Morse code moved on their own, releasing painful electric shocks. Along the very few electrical lines that existed at the time, there were numerous fires, with wooden poles going up in smoke and large sections collapsing. The Picayune newspaper of New Orleans reported that crowds gathered on street corners to watch the auroras. Some feared it was a warning of an impending disaster, an epidemic, or even the end of the world. In the city of Boston, it was thought that there was a terrible fire somewhere, but the source couldn't be identified. A few tens of minutes later, the color of the auroras changed to green, and then it was understood that it was a phenomenon related to the sky. In more recent times, it has been calculated that the solar storm triggered by the flare observed by Carrington had a power at least 10 times greater than the one that hit Quebec in 1989, and at least 20 times more intense than the one we've just experienced recently. It caused no harm after all. It just put on a show, but only because there wasn't a fragile technological civilization like ours to devastate. But this is nothing compared to the surprise that the immense nuclear power plant we call the Sun gave to our late Paleolithic ancestors. You already know that trees talk to us. They do so primarily through their woody trunks, providing us with valuable and timeless information such as climate change trends, environmental health insights, and even glimpses into our universe. By examining growth rings in Scots pine trunks discovered in France, an international team of scientists stumbled upon traces of an enormous solar storm that occurred over 14,000 years ago, the largest ever recorded so far. Researchers achieved this by measuring radiocarbon levels in the remains of ancient trees on the eroded banks of the Druze River in the southern French Alps. The results unveiled unprecedented radiocarbon spikes dating back 14,300 years. Comparing this radiocarbon peak with beryllium measurements, a chemical element found in Greenland ice cores, led the research team to speculate that the spike was caused by a massive solar storm, linked to the ejection of enormous volumes of energetic particles into Earth's atmosphere, an event 10 times more intense and destructive than the Carrington event. Of course, we're delving into the realm of possibilities here. We've only just realized that the Sun might throw us curveballs in the future. But we still know very little about the mechanisms governing the emergence of potentially devastating solar flares for our planet. Humanity does, however, have options. When the next big storm hits us, the consequences could look very different depending on what we do today. We can design satellites to be more resilient to geomagnetic storms. We can strengthen our power grids, particularly our transformers, like Quebec spent over $1 billion on after its power outage. While U.S. power transmission providers have recently initiated this process, their precautions seem to be designed for weaker storms, not events on the scale of those in 1859 or the Paleolithic era. So yes, there's a big one in our relationship with the Sun too. We expect it might come tomorrow. But for now, all we can do is hope it doesn't happen for at least the next 100 years. The minimum time needed to find solutions and countermeasures.